Test one, test two. Almost ready. We're going live.
To the corner with a man. Boy, that makes a dangerous jump. I've been here for sure. No
more. I'm Mr. Bomb.
What's up, Lemon? What's up? Greetings, greetings. All right. We're getting set. As you join, please, I want to make sure that audio is good. So give me a thumbs up, give me a heart, give me something. Of course, as we listen to the Portugal and China. This evening is going to be a special one. Start a watch party, do a share. Some vibes to the comment session, say a greeting so I can know who is on the line. Greetings, greetings, greetings. I hope the audio is coming through loud and clear. Welcome to Wataguan. My name is Donovan Simon. I'm the president for the Jamaican Canadian Association Alberta, based here in Calgary. And Wataguan is our way of connecting to the community, talking about issues that affect our association, affect our city, affect our country, affect Jamaica, affect the world, right? And this evening we have a really exciting topic. I'm really excited about this one. I'm going to talk about men's health, right? But of course, before we get into the discussion, we have a few things that are standard to Wataguan that we have to do, right? And I think this one is going to be really, really relevant because in a couple of days, boy, this is what is going to happen. So we start with a patois phrase of the day. And Jamaican patois is a really exciting language. So for those who hear us talk it all the time and don't necessarily understand what it is, part of what we do on Wataguan is share a couple of these words and phrases so that you can get to learn a little about it and, of course, understand what we are saying. So the patois phrase of the day is free paper bun. So next week, this is going to happen for quite a few people. And if we were to use it in a sentence in Jamaica, we would say, next week, your free paper bun. Next week, your free paper bun. So for the Jamaicans on the show, for those who understand the Jamaican patois, explain, add some explanation in the comment section, please, as to what free paper bun mean. All right. Of course, we're going to talk a little bit about some events that are coming up that we want you to be aware of here in Calgary. So on September 6th, there's an effort. Kim Connects is doing something called Unity Fest over at the Falcon Ridge Community Center. It starts at, I think, about 10:30. Between 10:30 and 11 a year, there's free breakfast for the kids, right? And it goes on all day. So there's music and all kinds of different activities. September 6th over at the Falcon Ridge Community Center. Go over and enjoy some cultural vibes and music and all kinds of different activity. There is the Getting Your Affairs in Order webinar that's online. It's on September 10th. There's one at 7 p.m. and there's another one on the 18th at 11 a.m. If you jump on either Instagram or Facebook and look for Getting Your Affairs in Order, I've attended these seminars a few times, and I tell you, it's really interesting the things you learn about just preparing for, you know, sometimes that are inevitable and everybody have to deal with, you know, death and the passing of a loved one. So jump on and get that one. This is also important. The Jamaican Canadian Association Alberta, we're going to restart having our general meetings in September. Since the COVID pandemic in March, we have paused because of the different regulations having our general meeting, but we're going to get back out in September. So September 26th, Saturday, September 26th, at 7 o'clock at the Winston Heights Community Center, right? We're going to have our general meeting. We're going to, of course, have a couple of protocols around managing the situation, managing the COVID-19 regulations as given by Alberta Health. But we want to get back out there. We want to get back meeting in person. So check our website, check our Facebook, check our Instagram to get updates on you know, what we're going to do, the protocols that you're expected to follow to be a part of this meeting. We're also going to provide a digital stream so that people who can't attend or who are not yet fully comfortable getting out there can still participate. I also want to give notice that our annual general meeting is scheduled for the end of October, and we will be having that in person as well. The last little thing I want to talk about before we jump into this exciting discussion about men's health with Dr. Unati is the Jamaican general elections are on September 3rd. I hope the Jamaicans have been watching the debates. There was a one on social issues on Tuesday, one on finance and the economy yesterday, and then the leaders are going to square off tomorrow at 8 o'clock Jamaica time, 7 o'clock Calgary time. But more important to me is that the Jamaicans who are eligible to vote, the ones that are in Jamaica who are watching this program, go out and exercise your right to vote, contribute to the process, contribute to the choosing of those who are going to make decisions on your behalf. Because if you don't go, somebody's going to go out and make those choices, and that is going to influence you. So get out there, be a part of the process, vote, wear your mask, because that is part of the requirement, right? So patois phrase of the day before I get into the discussion is free paper bun, right? Free paper bun, and it's going to happen for a couple of people shortly. But today we're going to talk about men's health, and I want to bring on a really exciting person, Dr. Unati. All right, let me bring her on first, and then I'll do the introduction, because you know what? I have attended a couple of sessions that she does. She has a program on Sunday mornings at 7 o'clock, primarily about men's health. So yeah, you can get up early and watch the program, and she will talk about that a little bit more. Dr. Unati, you have to unmute yourself. Unmute yourself and let's get going, because I know you're as excited as me to talk about this. How are you?
I'm good, John. How are you? Thanks for having me.
I am pretty good. I am pretty good. All right. Thanks for joining the program. You know, I've watched a couple of your shows, and I think it's really important for us to get into the discussion about men's health. Now, you're a medical practitioner here in Calgary, born in South Africa, and something said to you, you know, I need to talk about men's health because it's something that doesn't get talked about enough. And there are a lot of issues, right, that get swept away, or in some cases totally ignored. For example, I was looking at some stats today, and the rate of suicide in men is about 17.9 per 100,000 versus 5.3 per 100,000 for women. So let's start by just kind of setting the stage. What are some of the things about men's health that you think we need to give more attention to?
Thank you so much, Don, for this. You know, it's my favorite, you know, and like you said, it's not talked about. And really, this is something I have passion for. And part of it is because I'm a mom to a boy child, and I wanted him to live from vulnerability. Honestly, I want my boy to feel emotions. And I know that this is multicultural. You know, it's not only us African people. I take you guys as African because of your history. It's also around, I mean, it's here in this side of the world. So it's something that I feel we need to talk about, issues that matter to men. And mental health is something that is close to my heart. I talk lots about mental health. I talk about men's sexual health because those two things go together, right? And physically, but mostly these things, they basically overlap. So it's men's health, mental health, and diabetes, because diabetes tends to cause erectile dysfunction. So to me, diabetes could lead to sexual dysfunction and could lead to mental health issues. So I tend to talk about those three things. And of course, I talk about other things too, like prostate cancer or, you know, prostate hypertrophy, which is the enlargement of the prostate. But those three things are major for me. Depression, I speak a lot on it.
Well, let's talk about that, because one of the shows that you did was talking about PTSD, yeah, right, in men. And the fact that it in men, it is later in the process that they either get diagnosed or seek treatment, which in some ways contributes to things like abuse in the home, alcoholism, and ultimately suicide. So let's talk about that a little bit. Why is it that our men are not addressing these issues earlier, or their families are not pushing them towards getting help?
Good question, Don. You know what? Like I said in the beginning, this is multicultural. You know, how I've seen growing up too as a little girl, even our mothers, if a boy child had something sore or, you know, something painful, you know, boys were expected to be strong, you know, come on, you know, you'll be okay. You know, that is common multiculturally. So I think it starts there. It's something I don't know where it came from. Boys or men are expected to be strong, to toughen up and, you know, bottle their emotions. I honestly think it comes from that place. And then men or boys, they don't get to be vulnerable and feel their emotions, all right? So that's basically usually what happens to boys, and they grow up knowing that they have to be strong, bottle up their emotions. And then there's other things that happen to them. Actually, things like sexual abuse is very common in men or boys. Some of them, they've never even shared it with their parents or their spouse. You know, so those are the things that we get to hear about at our offices, and people, they would share these things after maybe being 40 or 50, and they basically manifest in how they're showing up in relationships, right? Someone could not show up completely to his spouse or to his partner because of fear of commitment or fear of even showing their vulnerability, because relationships, it's all about vulnerable and also showing up in a way that would satisfy your partner. And of course, there's things like work. You know, a lot of men have worked in the army. People were soldiers. So yeah, about PTSD, people who worked in such jobs, when they come back because, I mean, they've seen killings. They've seen people dying painfully, you know, burns, dying guns, that's traumatic to emotions, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah, I think a lot of times people, they tend to come back because they are depressed, and then that really affects the family unit. It's usually, interestingly, it's usually the spouses that come. Usually we see the wives or maybe girlfriends coming to us saying, you know, I'm concerned about my partner. And then eventually the partners come. So again, usually the mouthpiece is usually the partner.
Right.
Because it's starting to affect how they're relating or how that person is showing up, even actually in their romance, you know,
right.
They're not really interested in being affectionate, you know, so it does affect relationships. So that's why spouses come, they're concerned, what's going on with my husband? And actually some people, they even divorce.
Right.
Yeah.
So the issue of men's health therefore kind of drifts itself back into social issues, right? Because there's this correlation. It also ties itself, because one of the topics I remember you talking about was obesity and its impact on testosterone levels and how that affects relationships. Let's talk about that a little, because the whole issue of these correlated components around the family unit or relationships and health also tend not to get discussed, right? Because people only think it's one reason.
God. You should check my gut. I'm so impressed with you. You're just amazing. Thank you so much. You know,
right?
Yeah, you know, obesity is something that we are treating aggressively now, because like you said, it affects testosterone levels. Because when you are obese, basically what happens, your receptors where basically your testosterone should attach to, they basically covered by all this fat from obesity. So really you're not getting what you need throughout your system. So that's basically what happens. And a lot of times men, when they hit their 40s, testosterone levels tends to go down. And I always tell them, this is more like your menopause. Like women, when they hit their mid 40s, they also start getting menopausal symptoms. So are the men. So basically, I always try to make my male patients understand that it's just one of those things that is inevitable. 40% of men, actually, I would like people here, our viewers, to note this. 40% of men, once they reach 40, there will be a decline in their testosterone levels. So is erection. So that's why we always encourage people to live a healthy life. Obesity tends to reduce that testosterone. And in turn, testosterone levels, when they are low, you have erectile dysfunction. And then that contributes to how you feel about yourself. Because, I mean, when your testosterone levels are low and you don't have the drive, you want to have sexual intercourse, you want to be intimate with your partner. But unfortunately, you're not getting the adequate erection. And then what happens? And if you don't have a supportive spouse, that can be hard on your emotions. Now you are addressing this issue internally. You're scared to even start even becoming affectionate, because you know that it might not get to that point where it would satisfy your partner. And then you become withdrawn, right? So something like obesity could eventually lead to mental health issues. You become withdrawn because now you're not showing up as expected by your partner. And then depression sets in.
Mm-hmm.
And then that could also lead to something else, Don. We start seeing people becoming alcoholics or abusing drugs.
Right.
Unfortunately, alcohol itself and drugs could lead to erectile dysfunction. So it's just a health issue. I always tell my patients, obesity is treated like high blood pressure, like diabetes. We actually treat it literally with medication. So if your viewers are interested in that, they could talk to their doctors. Obesity is treated. And of course, there's other things that obesity could cause, diabetes, which diabetes in turn could cause erectile dysfunction. And also diabetes could cause high cholesterol, which also could actually block the vessels, your arteries, supplying your genital system. So it's a cycle, Dawn.
Yeah. Well, like I was saying, everything is connected.
Yes.
One of the connections is also the community and culture. So let's talk a little bit, because I, you know, this is a community program, and there is, you know, you started out by talking about how we grow our children,
yes.
Right? You know, in Jamaica, there's a boy, they must tough, them can't be a sissy.
I know what you mean. I got it. And honestly, that's how it is, even in Africa. And honestly, I think the advice here, we need to look at our boy children like we do with our girls. I have two kids. I have a boy and a girl. How I view my son is the same as his sister. I'm not expecting him to be tough. I want him to feel his emotion. I want him to be vulnerable, because this is how he's going to share his thoughts when he's struggling, because life will hit, you know, like it does to everyone. So I think as a society, we need to switch our thought form from that mentality of boys are strong. And that's how our boys will learn to be seeing themselves. And it's not even about you making your boy a sissy. There still need to be a father figure in that boy child, because we still need the boys to show up and in that masculinity, right? Mm-hmm. So, but at the same time, there's a thin line there. You don't want to also take away their emotions in mm-hmm. the name of mm-hmm. wanting to be strong. There mm-hmm. still needs to be that man, the father. It doesn't matter if you're a single parent, find that uncle. And I always say, find that uncle you have no romantic relationship with. Because another issue, a lot of times parents tend to do, you are involved with this man and then the relationship ends. What happens to your boy, right? So I always say, find that family you aspire to have your child to view as, this is a beautiful family with great principles, great values that I love. You share those values. And you know that continuity, I mean, that relationship will have continuity. And then your son will have that uncle whom he looks up to, right? Yes. Right. So it's a matter of, like we say in Africa, it takes a village to raise.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, honestly, even here, I see it even here in the Caucasian culture, that's how they view it, right?
Yeah.
So it's just a matter of, we need to let our boys feel their emotions, Don.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit about a couple of systematic things though. Like one, I'm gonna go from the health system. Is there enough focus on men's health? Is there enough that is being done to create some of the awareness that you're trying to create? What needs to happen there? What are some of the changes that you think need to occur?
I think at a provincial level, or actually as a country, I think countries need to legislatively, we need to start speaking. And I honestly think this COVID-19 has helped countries so much, because men are starting to feel their emotions. Men are starting to speak up, right? So this is an opportunity for every country actually to start speaking. Like for myself, I'm in a position where I could speak. I would love to have a platform where I could be in a situation where I could speak at a national level and speak about these issues. Because here's the thing, Don, we started seeing domestic violence right in this COVID-19. China reported numbers, right? Italy reported numbers. So is in Africa, like globally. So men, and they tend to actually express their fears, their depression in violence. That's right. How they show up sometimes. There's so much anger. So I think this COVID-19 is here to show us to be more sensitive and start looking at humans in general, not to separate men as this entity. It's just about time. I feel the government needs to start doing all these programs, because there are programs out there. There's campaigns on other issues. So mm-hmm. it's a matter of governments. Our governments need to do something. And in your case, you could start, you know, organization, you know, Jamaican Association is a humongous organization. So these are the things that you need to start speaking about and normalizing emotions. That's where we need to start. And also helping men, because honestly, even in our practices, we don't have many male patients. Men are scared to come. Men, it takes actually even over a year for a man to realize that they are depressed. So once we start doing these, so at grassroots levels, you know, in your organizations, start speaking up, start doing these campaigns so that men can see, oh, I'm not the only person. Because I think once you see the other person is also struggling, you mm-hmm. start seeing yourself as, I'm not different. I'm not abnormal. Like I was saying, things will happen. Once you hit 40, there's so many changes in your body. It's inevitable.
Yeah. Is that where the heel starts going the other way?
But you can always, you know what, John? There's something we always say to people, always try to, I mean, there's that biological age. A lot of times people, they are 40, but biologically they are 80. So it starts with looking after our bodies.
Yeah, right? Because
if we don't look after our bodies, how are we going to look after our mental health? And actually, it's all overlapping, really, because when we don't feel good about ourselves, it's easy for ourselves to let ourselves be obese, and then it becomes a vicious cycle. You become obese, and then you are at risk of developing diabetes, and then your testosterone levels are low, and then depression kicks in, and then it affects your relationships. So I think it's about time we talk about men's health as something that is a normal. Like, we need to set days where we say it's a men's health day, right? I think it's just about time.
So here I have two more quick questions here, because by the clock is ticking. You talk about community associations like ours, and I mean, there are a range of, you know, different nonprofits. I don't know of any that focuses primarily on men and men's health. So how do we get the dialogue going? Where do we put some of these conversations? You know, I'm looking for ideas and thoughts as to how the community contributes to some of this conversation.
TV, people watch TV. People watch TV, radios. I honestly think it's just about time. I know that it's been impressive watching what's been playing since COVID-19 happened. I'm starting to see more of Black Lives Matter issues addressed even on TV. That's not even, I mean, what we're talking about, it affects men interracially. So I honestly think people watch TV. It's just about time we start speaking about these issues and normalizing them. So something like TV, radio, and just doing campaigns. Honestly, I feel it's just about time. And also churches, like, I mean, all these organizations where there's men.
But aren't some of these topics taboo in some of these in some of these institutions and part of some of these cultures, right? Because, you know, prior to watching your show and, you know, creating some of these correlations, it's not something that's mainstream. You know, whoever connects obesity to testosterone levels, to sexual performance, to relationships, to abuse, it you know, we tend to see these as disconnected issues.
Yes, and yet they are connected. And yet they are connected because, like, honestly, I've seen men withdrawing, like either going through divorce because they are not showing up in the relationship. Women, they saying, I cannot reach out to my partner. I've been trying, right? And of course, it depends on the relationship they have. And then men just go, a lot of men, they are in that shell, right? So like I said, it's just about time we start normalizing these things. I always, when I open my mouth, I always discuss this with men. When you reach 40, it's inevitable. There's changes that are occurring in your body. There's something that is happening in your body. So now how are you going to help your body not age, right? Because it's like genes. If, Dawn, you have a gene for diabetes, it's up to you to switch it on or off by living your life healthily.
Right, right.
Yes. So I honestly think it goes back to, we need to talk about these issues. And I was saying, we see a lot of Oprahs, you know, Michelle Obama's, you know, speaking on women, like girls empowerment. And I love that. I'm a feminist, but where are men? Where are you, Dawn? Where are men speaking?
Yeah. Here I am.
Right? That's why right now I'm showing up, because as a physician in my position, I have at least a voice, you know, but we need more voices. We need more people on board, and we need to start talking about these issues at home, in our churches, in our organizations, you know, because there's so many organizations. And I think, honestly, I always say, because a lot of times even my colleagues are asking me, why men's health? And I go like, we birthed boys. What happened to that love we had for our little boys? You know, what happens to it? So I honestly think if there's no men that are showing up, because again, men, they also tend to be embarrassed because some of them, they're experiencing these issues themselves. Right. So it's about time as women to step up and talk about these issues. So that's why I'm here to talk about them. And I would love to see more women talking and also more men, to be honest, because some men, they're not comfortable seeing a woman. But at the end of the day, we need to talk about these issues.
Well, listen, this is awesome. You do a program. Let's get some information on the program, because I'd love other people to join in and benefit from some of the things you're sharing on relationships, on health in different areas of men's health. So when's your show on?
Yes, I do it on Sundays. It's at 7 a.m. MST. And it's just for an hour, 7 to 8 a.m. different shows. Actually, because I traveled, I'm actually out of town now. So unfortunately, tomorrow I have few meetings. It's not going to be tomorrow, I mean, on Sunday. But next week, we'll be back. And we discuss all sorts of issues.
Oh, Don, yeah.
You've seen it. We've done mental health. We've done physical health. And actually, I'm going to be, it's either I'll be switching to podcast so that we can reach more people, because I know that there's that time factor. People are not able to wake up on time, right?
So 7 o'clock, tough. But it's recorded, so you know we can go back and watch it, right?
Exactly. Yeah, I've been enjoying it. It's been amazing. People are grateful. People are learning, and it's such a nice environment where it's free from judgment. There's no one who feels judged. People are able to ask questions anonymously if they're not free to talk. But it's been beautiful. It's been a humbling experience for me to help these men globally, because we have people in Africa, in Canada, you know, so it's been great. We've been joined by even other people in the States. So it's growing. I love it.
It's awesome. I have been on the program, so I know, and you know, there's lots of learning, and I ask my questions too, right? Because I think some of these things give us an opportunity to bring out ideas that previously, you know, we kind of never considered.
Yes.
All right, Dr. Unati, it's a pleasure. Thanks for joining. Safe travels wherever you are. And we'll keep this conversation going.
Yes. Right? Thank you so much, Dad, for having me.
All right, take it easy. Stay safe. Stay
Thank
safe.
You.
All right, that was an awesome discussion on men's health. And tonight, we're going to have an extended conversation, because we're going to talk about back to school. Right?
All right.
Right, we're going to talk about back to school.
Homeschool my son. I'm so scared to. But I mean, the thing is, the kids, the stats shows they don't get it severe, but what if they bring it home and then adults get it, right? So and my son was like, no, I don't want to go.
In Jamaica, we'd say, if them bring it home, you send them back with it.
I wish, Don. I wish, yeah. So yeah, Don, you know what? I'll be I could still continue with the webinars, but I just noticed the attendance has been going down, and I think it's because of the time, right?
Yeah.
And I need to create more space on my computer. You were saying I saved it, but for some reason I need to delete some of the stuff. Last week I forgot to record it. Like, oh my gosh. Yeah, so I think it's going to be more practical when I do. The whole point of starting the webinar was to see the response from you guys. It was beautiful. But I think doing a podcast is going to be great. I mean, people could still do Sundays. I'm still available. I'm okay continuing, because I mean, it's a matter of people come and go. People come and go. But we're going to have a podcast, because the podcast, I wanted to even be broad. We're going to bring people to talk about even finances, because they do affect men.
Right.
Yeah,
well, so make sure you send the information to me so I can share it with all the other people.
Yes. And yeah, I just got myself all my podcast stuff, and I'm going to be training on it. So I'll let you know when it's
all right. Happens. Sounds good. All right, Dr. Unati, take care, and we'll be in touch. All right?
So much. Yes.
All right,
you
take
are
care.
So smart. Oh, my gosh. I'm like, Don, you are ready for me, right? I enjoyed it. Thank you so much.
All right, you're welcome. Take care.
Okay, take care. Bye.
All right, so we're going to talk about back to school, because that's an important thing. And we have a couple of people waiting in the wings, right, to have a discussion. So, Pennant, you have to take off your microphone, things.
Mute.
Are you the virgin?
Man, that was a great discussion, man. And I think it is so important that men do get in line with this men's health thing. And I get sometimes they're bashful and shy, but I think it's she made some really salient points. And I think that is something that should be continue to be talked about in our community, and men can do it, definitely.
All right. So before people jump off, when is the Black Hair conversation? I will see a couple of one. We're going to talk about that. So next we're going to talk about back to school. And for the people who are hanging on, we have a couple of sessions on what are going on. Today is the extended version because we're doing a little experiment. We're merging what was Jamkian viewpoint with what are going on once a month.
Yes.
To extend the conversation and to look at what is happening in the community. Next week on what are going on, we're going to talk about getting old. We're going to have Kathy and Jasmine coming on to talk about some of the things that we need to prepare for. Things that we need to look at, things that we need to consider, because who knows? Is that are you getting old? Well, all are we getting old? But you might have a parent or a relative, and you know, what are some of the things that we have to deal with? September 11, we're going to talk about building a business. We're going to have Ayo, we're going to have Natasha and Andrea talking about the different stages and the things that are important, especially in the Black community. September 18th, we're going to talk about Black hair, right? What to do, what not to do, natural or not natural, right? That's a suggestion that came from the viewers. So we're going to have that conversation. And September 25th, that's going to be a big one because we're going to talk about the Jamaican diaspora. How do we contribute to the rock, right? And I'm going to have Dr. Karen Dunkley. I'm going to have Nela Gordon DeCicio, who are members of the Global Jamaica Diaspora Council. And I'm also going to try to get Dr. Hugh Rainford on, a Jamaican living overseas, active part of the diaspora, to think about or talk about what do we do, how do we contribute to the rock. So lots of good conversation coming up on what are going on. But we're going to go and pass it on to David, you know, because we're going to talk about back to school. So let me bring some people in because it's not me I'm going to talk to. So here we go, David.
Yes.
Natalie.
Thank you, Donovan. I appreciate that, sir. Great, great, great conversation. Yes, yeah, so we have Natalie and we have Ashley. But before we do talk to the people that we know, welcome everyone to another viewpoint. And as Donovan said, it's an extension of what we're doing with Watagwan. So, but before we get into the conversation, I wanted to say thank you to Hermeline Simon, Nicole Lewis, and Bernadette Griffiths for the great job that they did with the back to school backpack that giveaway that we did last week Saturday and on Wednesday as well too. It was a very, very great success. I mean, every item that we have was given away, and many people who were really in need of those things came. So thank you again, ladies, for our job well done on the behalf of the association. I really, really thank you. Now, as Donovan mentioned, we're going to be talking about back to school and in the presence of COVID as well too. And of course, we know that every parent, every teacher, everyone right now is having anxiety issues as to the back to school right now because of the COVID, the presence of COVID, which is not going away anytime soon. So here in Alberta, school is potentially going to be already set to open on September 1st. So we are looking at what the CB, that's the Calgary Board of Education, said that September 1st, there is going to be school opening. Of course, it's a dual thing. Part is going to be online and part is going to be in the brick and mortar building, of course. They said 21% of the schools that have been student registered right now are going to be online and the registration is closed. But I want you to also go to the website for the CBE, that's the Calgary Board of Education, and you will see more information with regard to the schools opening, what's going to take place, transportation. I mean, there are tons of information that you want to get, and make sure you go to the right source, not listen to what people are saying on the street, but go to the source so you can be appropriately informed, okay? So registration is closed, but school opens on September 1st. I want to make sure that you are there to get your kids there. And whatever anxiety you have information so you can do and make very good decisions about that. So tonight we're gonna be talking to Miss Natalie Sano and Miss Ashley Green. So Natalie is a social worker and she's actually a crisis intervention social worker. So she works with the mobile department, or they say the mobile unit of the AHS, that's the Alberta Health Hospital Association. And so, of course, she's the person you call when there's an issue. She and her team comes in and they take care of you right there, and then they transport you, I guess, to the facility. She has been around for a long time, and definitely as a crisis intervention person, you want to make sure that you have an expert like her, someone who's very much a parent and also a healthcare worker on the front line. So, you know, the compassion is there as well too. So welcome, Natalie. Yes, you got your unmute, right?
There we go. Thank you.
Thank you. And also we have Ashley Green. Now, Ashley seems like she's becoming a staple now. Ashley's the second time for Ashley. And Ashley, are you back from Jamaica?
No, I'm still in Jamaica. I'm trying to stay for quite a while.
So. She's still in Jamaica. Okay, Ashley. And Ashley is a student at the University of Calgary. Okay, and she's going to be going to as a sophomore here, I believe, Ashley, right? Good. So we're going to be talking to both. We were going to actually have another person who's a teacher, but unfortunately she had to cancel because of other pressing issues. So we're going to be talking about back to school in the presence of COVID. So Ashley, I'm going to start with you as a student, okay? And what is your anxiety level right now in terms of going back to school?
Personal for me is not that high, maybe because for a portion of last semester we had to transition online, so I believe there's like some sort of familiarity with it, but for others, from students on my school, it seems like most students have a really high level of anxiety towards online learning, because, you know, not everybody can find the will to actually go on online classes every day.
And in terms of the online, that you found that you at least have some familiarity with that, right? But regarding the COVID itself, the COVID-19 scare, is it something that you are worried about, that maybe you have to go on campus at some point in time for any classes, maybe lab classes or anything like that?
Yes, I was worried because initially I had a lab that had to be on campus, right? And what the schools were doing is, if you have a class that's, they term it as if you have small classes, so I'm guessing about like to 15 to 20 students, they would have those classes on campus. And I was like, so I'm supposed to leave my house in the pandemic and socialize with students. And I'm like, it's more of the fear of not knowing who has what and who has touched what, because remember, it's not only about wearing the mask or the gloves, because I'm not sure what you have come in contact with, and we have to be interacting with the same resources, the same tools. So I was very worried about the idea of returning to campus. So I was like, what are the protocols? What does the school have in place to protect me? Because I do believe that there are a few people that should be on campus now, mostly research students and staff and such like that. But going to university in the COVID, it's a big concern.
Okay, thank you, Ashley. Now, Natalie, I'm going to switch gears to you a little bit. Now, Ashley is a college student. So in terms of protocol and even the way they may conduct themselves, they're more mature. So therefore, they're going to be able to make more, you know, informed decisions as to where they go and who they contact with and how they really navigate through those spaces. Mm-hmm. For younger kids, okay, you're a mom. For younger kids, elementary kids, kids who are in pre-kindergarten, kindergarten, and the middle school kids, which are, you know, very, you know, they're high energy. What are some of the things that, as you as an intervention person, would you advise best right now?
Huge question, because not only am I a professional, but I am a mom with a young child as well. So I think the biggest thing is to be informed, to make sure you teach your children what they need to do. Mm-hmm. With this pandemic, it's a new normal. I don't think COVID is going away anytime soon. So the way in which we do things have to be different. So it's about teaching your children the importance of washing your hands, the importance of keeping your distance, coughing in your sleeve. I mean, those are things that we've talked about before, but I think it's heightened now because it's a new reality. Things have to happen differently. Teaching them the importance of wearing the mask. And teaching them the importance of, okay, you need to do what you need to do to protect yourself. But just as Ashley said, you don't know what other people are doing. You don't know what other students are exposed to and how they're keeping themselves healthy or what precautions they're putting in place for themselves. So it really is about taking the time to educate your children on what they need to do differently. And it's amazing how adaptable our children are. You teach them, they'll gravitate to it.
So we're talking about kids here, and I want to go back to the little kids, right? Because I know that their attention span is like that. Good. And of course, you want to make sure that they are safe. And as they say, you know, kids are germ bags because they go to school and they bring up everything with them, right? They never think about those things. But do you think that the city or the local government, in terms of what they're doing right now, and believe me, I think they're doing a lot in terms of what I've seen on their website, to invest more in making more space for schools?
I think that the government here are doing the best that they can with unprecedented days. They are having the options for students or for families to do online part-time or hub learning as opposed to everybody in the classroom. I think that you as a parent have to be informed in terms of what they're doing, but I think they're doing the best that they can. And I guess I'm coming from a place that I have to trust that these government people that make the big money, that, and we're not in America, right? And I say that maybe disregardingly, but we're not in America. There isn't a political game to, in terms of their inability to look at the stats and look at what needs to happen and how quickly things need to change. We've been very blessed that here in Canada, in Calgary, they happened very quickly. Schools were shut down when they needed to, because I do believe that they have everybody's interest at heart.
Good. Now, Ashley, I want you to weigh in on this as well too, and as Natalie as well. We look at kids, and we're talking about the school buses right now, because parents have to go to work. So that's one issue we'll talk about. Kids have to go on the school buses. Of course, these buses they're going to be interacting with each other, and proximity is going to be an issue. What do you think, Ashley, as a young person, what you think would be the best thing right now to suggest to parents who are listening right now for those kids on the bus in terms of proximity and protection? What do you think would be the best thing for them?
Did you repeat the last part of that sentence?
For parents who are going to be allowing their kids on the buses, as a young person who have interacted with kids, what would you think is the best advice to give to those parents?
Yeah, can you finish? I didn't hear the ending of that. Advice to the parents about?
In terms of the kids being on the buses.
About traveling on the buses?
Yes, the school buses.
Okay, we're having some connection issues. Okay. Ms. Natalie said, I do believe it's about educating the children, because if you don't know what's right, we can't practice what's right. And we need to get that idea in our head that this is a pandemic. We need to be careful. We need to be mindful of others. So I think parents really need to teach their children how to go about traveling while on the buses. Make sure you have on your mask. The 6 feet, the social distance rules applies. Please ensure that your kids know that you can't be going around touching everything and interacting with everybody, because it's something that can be easily transmitted per se. And I believe that the parents should provide the necessary resources for kids, because even me as a young person, sometimes I'm a little paranoid to go on the bus. And my mom is like, okay, make sure you have your hand sanitizer, make sure you have your mask, make sure you have your gloves. Please remember that you should not be too close to somebody if you feel uncomfortable, because Jamaicans, how the system set up, being home and seeing kids still have to go into school and they're doing testings right now, it just looks like a big bundle. No social distancing. And we have a tendency to wear the mask, but we keep it below our nose. So I believe parents need to keep reminding their child, okay, this is something serious. You need to follow protocols, because you just covering your mouth is not enough. You need to be mindful of others. So I think that's something that they need to drill into their children and constantly remind them.
Good, thank you. Natalie, in terms of the mental aspect of things, right, where you're looking at, you're a parent, you're an educator, at the same time a social worker. Where you're looking at, parents have to go back to school, babysitting is gonna be an issue, okay? Because if you're gonna have homeschooling, some parents are gonna be homeschooling, babysitting is an issue and they have to go to work. What are some of the mental things that they have to really navigate right now to have that comfort level that they can do this going forward?
I think the biggest thing with anxiety levels with the new normal, I think we've had a few months to kind of prepare ourselves for it. I think the importance is making sure that you have a good support system, a support system in which you can speak about your anxieties, talk about your anxieties, but then still have the information that you need to be informed, right? Because anxieties come from a place of, you don't know, we don't know, we don't know. And there's some things with this pandemic, we really just don't know still. So having, being, making sure that we're informed, but then having a support group to help manage that. So, I mean, I do have a young child. I have a grade one child that we've chosen to stay home this year because of those anxieties, of the unknowns. And fortunately, I have a husband that's able to do that. I have my sister, my family to support me with that piece. But it is about relying on those other social supports to manage all of those anxieties that come in play with this pandemic.
So let me follow up on what you just mentioned, that you have to be homeschooling, basically. That's what you said without using the word homeschooling, right? Mm-hmm. Now, mm-hmm. And we're going to find a lot of parents are going to have that option. Really not necessarily that they chose it, but it has to be that it's going to be the option. You were never a part of homeschooling before. How are you finding that so far?
To be honest with you, I hate it. I don't want to be a teacher. I'm a mom. I mean, I'm a teacher in other ways. As a mother, you teach in all different types of ways, right? To be an educator for my child is not the ideal because I still work. I still work outside of my home. I still leave, and I have been doing that throughout this whole pandemic. So it's a challenge, definitely, in terms of managing the homework, managing the casework, the schoolwork, and ensuring that she's getting it done. Luckily, she's young, and she's still very keen on learning. So fortunately, I have that to my advantage, but I know that there's other parents that are struggling even more than I am, because being a parent and being a teacher, those two different skills. I mean, come on, I cannot underestimate the skill set it takes for a teacher to teach my child. They go to school to get a four-year degree, sometimes 5 or 6 year degree to teach my children. So I can't underestimate that, and which is why I was particular of how I was gonna do this homeschool piece. I wanted a teacher-led program as opposed to them sending me all of these books and trying to teach this little girl. I did want an online program that she can log online. I mean, and it has its disadvantages. Do I want my child in front of a screen for 3-4 hours a day? It's not ideal, but I'm just hoping that this will pass, or that there'll be another, we'll get some sort of guidelines, or there'll be some improvement in what happens and how we manage this.
Thank you. So we have to make some adaptations. Now, Ashley, as a young person in college, and of course you see the dichotomies that's taking place right now with teachers and students. Now, how adaptive should you think teachers should be with regards to sending homework to do and making sure that homework is done and the parents are a big part of it when it comes to the homeschool that is taking place right now are going to be taking place?
Okay, so I do believe professors and teachers need to set like a time limit and also expand assignment hours, because personally for me, what my school has done, because international students have returned home and other persons have traveled, they give you a 24-hour window to complete an assignment. or to upload a paper or such. And they're like, okay, you have the resources to do this. You have this amount of time because you're trying to, you know, include everybody. So that's, I find that reasonable. And they're like, okay, you're at home, you have your parents. The parents should be able to, you know, be, you have some very stubborn children, I must say. So parents have to take that. Some children need that push. You know, those, yeah, parents have to be their kids back, to per se. Mm-hmm. And in terms of homework and assignment for younger kids, it's kind of difficult, in my opinion, because I have nephews and nieces, because it's the parents really do the homework, if I'm speaking the truth. So, and then, you know, because they're already working and such, I believe the teachers are going to have to find alternatives if you for testing and assignments like that, because normally assignments are like a heavier bulk of the work. So they're going to have to portion it differently. They're going to have to find different ways to do that, or the few times they do meet over Zoom or such, I believe they have to get as much content in as possible, because there are a lot of issues with online learning that can come about. So I believe like assignments and testing is going to be a lot. It's going to be more difficult, to be honest.
So let me ask you,
just have to keep that time span in mind and the forums, the different forums they have to use.
And let me just follow up with something you just said in terms of the time factor and the issues. For a student who is just going to be starting the online classes, what would you suggest as a good help for them right now?
I mean, you have to be disciplined. I would say if you're new to it, I would suggest you read some articles or blogs online how to manage online learning, because I'm telling you, it can be very difficult if you procrastinate a lot. Trust me, you're going to waste time. I mean, we were normally, if we're talking on the phone, if somebody were watching a video, I mean, we have 5 different tabs open and we're switching from this one to that one. And so if you don't have that discipline, it really takes a toll on you. I mean, I'm not trying to scare anybody, but if you're new to it, I believe that speaking to your teacher or your professor, they might have some insightful knowledge also, because they can tell you a few tips on how to manage it better. Some people are like, since it's online for you, on university students, that's what I can speak about. You pick a time that you know is good for you, right? Because you normally have your 8 a.m., your 9 a.m., and 10 a.m. classes. So I think that's an advantage of online learning, the flexibility. So find what works for you. Find an hour that you know where you can focus during that hour. Don't go take a 7, 8, 9 o'clock p.m. class where you know you don't have that focus and you can't drive through that entire class. And I think you just will have to take it step by step. If you're very new to it, I feel like for the first week or days, you test the water, see what you're comfortable and what you're not comfortable with, and try and adjust.
Okay, good. That's definitely to make sure you get that discipline in and start to test the waters with at least small portions of things and be able to get those assignments done, because it does take time. Just because we're going to wrap up shortly, Natalie.
Mm-hmm.
What would be, you say, a most conscious advice as a social worker, as someone who's into crisis right now? We're in a crisis mode right now, as we are right now. What would be your best advice to parents and to educators out there right now in terms of how should they go forward in the next couple of weeks when school starts?
I think the biggest thing is to tap in those external supports. Talk to your family, talk to your friends. If you don't have that, tap into some professional support, counseling. There's the Distress Center that has free counseling. There's a variety of different counseling online as well. But I think the biggest thing is to talk about your concerns with somebody and keep yourself informed. Informed as to what the rates are, what are their recommendations in terms of what to do, how to keep ourselves healthy, and trying to maintain those social opportunities as well. Yes, our family dinners are not going to be the same. They haven't been the same as it over the last few months, but using the new normal, Zoom with family and friends, have a play date with your kids online, have birthday parties, Zoom birthday parties, but using the tools that we have already to get used to this new normal, because it ain't gonna go away.
Thank you very much. Well, folks, there you got it. You have to have a support group, family and friends. You know, we are going to get into something different, and we don't know how to navigate the landscape as yet. We are just really just learning as we go day by day. So make sure you have your support group. You know, make sure you're getting information from the right sources, because a lot of information is out there is not necessarily is good for you. So you must be able to make decisions and choices. And also for students, as Ashley says, you have to now adopt a new level of discipline as you go towards online schooling, making sure that you are understanding what you need to do, when you need to turn assignments, because it's going to be very critical in terms of timing. And of course, as they say, for parents, make sure you're educating your kids as to whether it's young kid or in the middle or high school, make sure that they are at least have the information how to protect themselves when they go out into the world there as well, because it's going to be dread, it's going to be rough. And for kids who are highly active, you know, they are not thinking about, okay, mom says, by the time they think about it, something has gone wrong already. So you want to make sure that they are actually on point with everything else. Ladies, thank you very much for your time. Thank you for your input. I know a lot of people out there got information, and they're going to be taking heed to some things as well, too, because we're all in this together, whether it's affecting you by school or at work or as a parent or teacher or otherwise, we are all in this together. So thank you very much, Natalie. Thank you, Ashley. Again, we are appreciative of your input and your insight as well, too. So folks, that's where we are right now. We are making sure that you as our listeners are getting everything. And we want to make sure that you are tuning to us every Friday, Donovan again, with his program. And we want to make sure that you are doing what you should be doing and making sure that your kids, you are safe with your family and everything. So as you go back to school, thank you again for joining us. And remember, next week, Donovan will be on again at 7 o'clock with Wataguan. And make sure that you tune in and take it good. Here we go. Walk good. Thank you. It's not an easy road.